Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Enjoy Biochemistry. I am Dr. Drupti. In this video, we are going to learn about urea cycle disorders. This video is continuation of my previous video on urea cycle. So before watching this video, I suggest you to watch that video first. I am giving the link in the description below. In the previous video, we have learned that urea is the end product of amino acid metabolism. In the amino acid metabolism, free ammonia is released. It is because of transamination and then oxidative deamination. Now that ammonia is very toxic, it has to be converted into less toxic form, and that's why there is formation of urea in the liver through urea cycle. This urea cycle, it has 5 important steps and 5 important enzymes. So if there is defect in any of the 5 enzymes, it leads to urea cycle disorders. So let's see each disorder one by one. So the first enzyme involved in urea cycle is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1. And this enzyme converts this carbon dioxide and ammonia to carbamoyl phosphate. So if there is defect in this enzyme, it leads to the condition hyperammonemia type 1. Second defect is, if the defect is in the second enzyme that is involved in the second reaction, that is formation of citrulline, it leads to the condition hyperammonemia type 2. So when the block is in one of the earlier step, that is step number 1 and 2, then the condition is more severe because there is accumulation of this ammonia. This ammonia cannot be converted into carbamoyl phosphate and later into this citrulline, because there is accumulation of ammonia which is toxic to the brain. And deficiency of later enzyme result in the accumulation of other intermediates which are less toxic, and the symptoms are less in the later urea cycle disorders. So this is hyperammonemia type 1 due to carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1 defect. There is accumulation of ammonia, and this condition, second condition, is hyperammonemia type 2. This is due to defect in ornithine transcarbamoylase, which is also called as OTC. Now the third defect is in the enzyme arginino-succinate synthetase. Now this enzyme converts this citrulline into arginino-succinate. So if this enzyme is defective, then there will be accumulation of citrulline because it cannot be converted into this arginino-succinate, and that's why this condition is called as citrullinemia, that is the accumulation of citrulline in the blood. This is the third disorder. The fourth one is due to defect in the fourth enzyme of urea cycle, that is arginino-succinase, or other name is arginino-succinate lyase. And this enzyme converts arginino-succinate into arginine. And if it is defective, then there will be accumulation of arginino-succinate in the blood, and which can be later excreted through urine. And that's why the condition is called as arginino-succinic acid urea. So this is the fourth urea cycle disorder. The fifth one is due to defect in the fifth enzyme, that is arginase. So this arginase converts arginine to ornithine, and if it is defective, then there will be accumulation of arginine, because now arginine cannot be converted into ornithine, and that's why the condition is called as hyperarginemia. There is increase in the arginine level in blood. So these are 5 important urea cycle disorders due to 5 important enzymes which are involved in this urea cycle. But along with these 5 disorders, there are 2 more which are associated with this urea cycle disorders. So the first one is N-acetylglutamate synthase deficiency. So we know that N-acetylglutamate, it is the allosteric activator of this enzyme carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, and this is required for its activity. So if it is deficient, then this carbamoyl phosphate cannot be formed, and there will be accumulation of ammonia. Though it is rare, but it can occur. That is N-acetylglutamate synthase deficiency. The next one is due to ornithine transport protein defect. Because we know that ornithine in the cytosol is transported in the mitochondria through this ornithine transporter. So if this is defective, then this ornithine cannot be transported and this second reaction cannot occur. So in this condition, there is accumulation of ornithine in the cytosol, and this condition is called as hyperornithemia, or it is also called as HHH syndrome. So in the later part of this video, we are going to see all these disorders in brief. Urea cycle disorders are characterized by hyperammonemia, and as ammonia is toxic, it leads to encephalopathy. It also stimulates hyperventilation or ventilation, so it leads to respiratory alkalosis. The ammonia level, normal level, is 10 to 40 micromole per liter, and the symptoms appear when in neonates when the level is more than 150 micromole per liter. The clinical symptoms mainly include vomiting, irritability, lethargy, severe mental retardation, and the infant appear normal at birth, but within days progressive lethargy sets in, and various like gastrointestinal symptoms which are associated with these urea cycle disorders are vomiting. In late onset hyperammonemia, there is aversion to the food, especially the food containing protein. There can be diarrhea, nausea, and neurological symptoms are there like seizures, lethargy, altered mental status, irritability, mental retardation, etc. So these are the common characteristic features of urea cycle disorders. Let's quickly learn why increased level of ammonia are toxic to the brain. So the first reason is that due to decreased alpha ketoglutarate and ATP generation. So why there is decreased alpha ketoglutarate? Because more ammonia, it binds with the alpha ketoglutarate to form glutamate, and that glutamate will also bind with ammonium ion, ammonia, to form glutamine. So more alpha ketoglutarate is utilized to form this glutamate and glutamine in ammonia if ammonia levels are high in the brain. And as alpha ketoglutarate is the intermediate of TCA cycle, then TCA cycle becomes less functional, and that's why there is less ATP generation. This is one of the important cause of ammonia toxicity. The second cause is that due to osmotic effects of glutamine. So there is more formation of glutamine if there is more concentration of ammonia, and this glutamine accumulation in the brain, it causes osmotic shift of water into the cells, and it leads to swelling and functional damage to the cells, which aggravates encephalopathy and again hyperammonemia as well. The third important reason is because of neurotransmitter role. There is increased glutamine and there is less glutamate because more glutamine is formed because ammonia combines with glutamate. So this leads to decreased level of GABA due to decreased glutamate, and it leads to harmful effects on the brain because GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. In addition to this, there is tryptophan entry into the brain cells, which leads to increased serotonin level because serotonin is synthesized from this tryptophan. And because of this new two neurotransmitter, that is decreased GABA and increased serotonin, it leads to ammonia aggravation of ammonia toxicity. The last important reason is that due to neuronal dysfunction, this hyperammonemia increases permeability of the neuronal membrane to potassium chloride ions, and it causes ionic imbalance, and it leads to bizarre behavior in the patients having increased level of ammonia. So these are the possible mechanisms of ammonia toxicity. Now let's see the key features of each of the urea cycle disorder, and the first one is hyperammonemia type 1. It is due to defect in first enzyme of urea cycle, that is CPS1, that is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1. Now, if this enzyme is defective, then this ammonia cannot combine with carbon dioxide to form carbamoyl phosphate. So, all five steps cannot occur in this condition. And this condition, that is hyperammonemia type 1, there is accumulation of ammonia occurs. It is autosomal recessive condition, comparatively rare, but it results in the severe hyperammonemia. This ammonia levels will build up in the blood, and it results in the mental retardation. In acute hyperammonemia, urgent hemodialysis is required for the elimination of ammonia from the blood. The second urea cycle disorder is hyperammonemia type 2, and it is due to defect in the second enzyme, that is ornithine transcarbamoylase, which is also called as OTC. So if this enzyme is defective, then carbamoyl phosphate cannot donate its carbamoyl group to ornithine to form citrulline. So there will be no formation of this citrulline and no further steps will occur. So it will lead to then accumulation of ammonia and increased level of carbamoyl phosphate. So this condition, hyperammonemia type 2, it has various characteristic features. Like it is the only X-linked recessive urea cycle disorders. All other urea cycle disorders are autosomal recessive, but this is the only urea cycle disorders which is X-linked recessive. Second important feature is that it is most common urea cycle disorder. OTC deficiency, that is hyperammonemia type 2, is most common UCD. In this condition, the mothers of affected child, the child who is affected, the mothers also show hyperammonemia and aversion to the protein food. And the neonate also shows hyperammonemia. There is increased glutamine level in blood, CSF and urine. Why there is increased glutamine level? Because due to deficient ornithine transcarbamylase, there is accumulation of ammonia because it cannot go into further urea cycles. So more accumulation of ammonia will lead to more conversion of glutamate to glutamine. So glutamate combines with ammonia to form glutamine. So more glutamine formation will occur and it will lead to increased glutamine level in the blood, CSF and urine. This condition is also characterized by orotic aciduria, and this is due to channeling of carbamoyl phosphate in the pyrimidine synthesis. Now, as this carbamoyl phosphate cannot be cannot donate its carbamoyl group to ornithine to form citrulline, there is increased accumulation of carbamoyl phosphate, and this carbamoyl phosphate is channeled to the pyrimidine synthesis. This intermediate is also involved in the pyrimidine synthesis, and it enters that pyrimidine synthesis after the regulatory step, and there is formation of orotic acid in the pyrimidine synthesis, and increased level of orotic acid leads to orotic aciduria, and that's why orotic aciduria occurs in hyperammonemia type 2. So these are the important characteristic features of hyperammonemia type 2. The third UCD is citrullinemia, and it occurs due to defect in the enzyme argininosuccinate synthetase, which converts citrulline to argininosuccinate. So if this enzyme is defective, then reaction number 3, 4, 5 cannot occur. So there is accumulation of citrulline. Hyperammonemia also occurs in this condition, but it is mild. It is not as severe as it occurs in the CPS1 deficiency and OTC deficiency, that is hyperammonemia type 1 and 2. So this is the autosomal recessive condition, which is characterized by hyperammonemia. As citrulline cannot be converted into argininosuccinate, there is increased levels of citrulline in blood, urine and CSF. And there are two types of citrullinemia. First, due to mutation in the regulator gene, and second is due to mutation in the structural gene. The fourth UCD is arginosuccinic aciduria, and this is due to defect in the fourth enzyme of UCD, that is arginosuccinase or arginosuccinate lyase. And if this enzyme is deficient, this arginosuccinate cannot be converted into arginine. So there is a decreased arginine level and increased arginosuccinate. So this condition is autosomal recessive. Hyperammonemia is less severe in this condition, and there is increased argininosuccinate level in the blood, urine and CSF, and this condition is called as arginosuccinic aciduria, which is a metabolic acidosis. And in this condition, there is typical clinical feature is seen, which is friable tufted hair. It is called as trichorhexis nodosa. Now in the treatment of this arginosuccinic aciduria, arginine is given to the patient. So what is the basis of giving arginine to the patient? In this condition, we know that arginosuccinate cannot be converted to arginine. But if this arginine can be given to the patient, it is converted to ornithine. Then ornithine is transported to the mitochondria. Now this ornithine can combine with this carbamoyl phosphate to form citrulline. Citrulline comes into the cytosol. Now citrulline can be converted into arginosuccinate. And we know that the arginosuccinate has two nitrogen atoms, one coming from this ammonia and second is coming from this aspartate. So increase arginine-succinate level in the blood and then excretion of arginine-succinate through urine. It provides the alternate route for excretion of nitrogen atom, which is present in the ammonia and which is present in the aspartate. So that's why it is the another way of removal of nitrogen through urine in the form of arginine-succinate, and that's why in these patients arginine is given. The fifth UCD is hyperarginemia. In this condition, there is defect in the enzyme arginase, which converts arginine into urea and ornithine. So if this arginase is defective, then arginine cannot be converted into urea and ornithine. So that's why there will be increased arginine level in the blood. This condition is autosomal recessive and it is a mild condition. Symptoms appear by 2 to 4 years of age, and as I have already said, it is characterized by increased arginine level. Hyperornithinemia or HH syndrome. It is characterized by defect in the ornithine transporter. This ornithine transporter is important for transport of this ornithine from cytosol to mitochondria. So this is due to defect in the ornithine transporter deficiency due to mutation in ONTN1 gene. And this condition is characterized by 3H. That's why it is called as HHH syndrome. So first H is increased level of ornithine, that is hyperornithinemia, because now ornithine cannot be transported in the mitochondria, so it cannot be utilized in the second step of urea cycle to form the citrulline. So there is increased ornithine level. Second is hyperammonemia and third is homocitrullinemia. What is homocitrulline? Normally what happens, the carbamoyl group from this carbamoyl phosphate, it is transferred to this ornithine in the mitochondria to form citrulline. Now ornithine is not available in the mitochondria due to this transporter defect. So that's why this carbamoyl group is now transferred to lysine, and lysine is carbamoylated to form homocitrulline, and that's why there is increased homocitrulline level in this condition, because lysine is carbamoylated to form homocitrulline. So this is about HHS syndrome. The laboratory test which can be carried out in the diagnosis of various urea cycle disorders are like estimation of ammonia, blood ammonia, electrolytes, glucose, pH, BUN, blood urea nitrogen, blood amino acids like glutamine, urine organic acid like orotic acid, lactic acid, DNA testing can be done, and newborn screening is done by analysis of neonate blood by tandem mass spectrometry. So these are the various laboratory tests which can be done to diagnose UCDs. Now what is the differential diagnosis of hyperammonemia in neonate? Means if neonate has increased ammonia level in his or her blood, then how to diagnose the various urea cycle disorders? So if the symptoms of hyperammonemia arise between 24 to 72 hours after birth, then we have to look for whether there is presence of acidosis or ketosis. If there is no acidosis or ketosis, then we have to suspect urea cycle disorder, and blood assay is done for the levels of citrulline. So citrulline assay is done. If the level of citrulline in blood is more than 1000 micromole per liter, then we have to suspect it is arginine-succinate synthetase deficiency. It is also called as citrullinemia. So if citrulline level is more than 1000 micromole per liter, it is the condition that is citrullinemia. Now if the citrulline level is between 100 to 300 micromoles per liter, then we have to estimate plasma arginine-succinate or anhydrides of arginine-succinate. And if plasma arginine-succinates are found to be higher side, then it is arginine-succinate lyase deficiency, that is arginine-succinic aciduria. And if citrulline levels are absent or only trace amount of citrulline is present, then urine orotic acid should be estimated, and if the levels are high, then it is OTC deficiency, that is ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency, and The name of UCD is hyperammonemia type 2. And if the urine orotic acid is not present or very low, then it is CPS1 deficiency, that is hyperammonemia type 1. So in this way, if the neonate presents with hyperammonemia and symptoms arise between 24 to 72 hours, various urea cycle disorders can be diagnosed. Coming to the management modalities of urea cycle disorders, the first management modality is dietary protein restriction. So protein should be restricted in the diet, and it is the mainstay of long-term management of hyperammonemia. Second is arginine should be provided in the diet. It promotes nitrogen excretion in the forms other than urea. In this condition, for example, in arginosuccinic acid urea, there is deficiency of arginosuccinate. So there is more formation of arginosuccinate. So if arginine is provided, then nitrogen, which is coming from ammonia and aspartate, now it is present in the arginosuccinate, so that nitrogen can be excreted in the form of citrulline and arginosuccinate. The second important feature of use of giving arginine in the diet is that arginine is the activator of this N-acetylglutamate. So by activating N-acetylglutamate, we indirectly increase the activity of enzyme, that is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, and that's why arginine should be provided in the diet. This is the second management modality. The third is lactulose. Lactulose is given and it causes reduced ammonia production in the gut. The fourth management modality is benzoate, and phenyl acetate is given to the patient to get rid of accumulated glycine and glutamine. So specifically in hyperammonemia type 1 and 2, in this condition, there is increased glycine and glutamine because now ammonia cannot be excreted. So ammonia combines with glutamate to form glutamine. So how to get rid of this glycine and glutamine? In this condition, benzoate is given. So this benzoate, it is converted into benzoyl CoA and it combines with glycine to form hippurate. So it is glycine can be excreted in the form of hippurate through urine. Phenyl acetate is given, it is converted to phenyl acetyl CoA, combines with glutamine to form phenyl acetyl glutamine, which can be later excreted. So that's how the nitrogen, which is present in glycine and glutamine, can be excreted in these ways by giving benzoate and phenyl acetate. So it's like a substitute for urea in the disposal of ammonia. And the last management modality is hemodialysis. So in acute conditions of hyperammonemia, it rapidly reduce the level of circulating ammonia. So hemodialysis is important in conditions of acute hyperammonemia. Let's summarize the important points of urea cycle and urea cycle disorders. The step 1 of urea cycle is synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate from ammonia and carbon dioxide, and the enzyme responsible is carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1, and this enzyme requires N-acetylglutamate for its activity. If this enzyme is defective, the condition that result is called as hyperammonemia type 1. In this condition, there is accumulation of ammonia and there is severe hyperammonemia is there, and this condition is autosomal recessive. In addition to ammonia, there is also increased glutamine level. Second is formation of citrulline from ornithine and carbamoyl phosphate. The enzyme responsible for step number 2 is ornithine transcarbamoylase, that is OTC. And if this enzyme is defective, ornithine transcarbamoylase, then citrulline cannot be formed. So this condition is called as hyperammonemia type 2. Product accumulated here is ammonia. This is the condition which is only urea cycle disorder which is X-linked recessive. It is the most common urea cycle disorder characterized by severe hyperammonemia. There is also increased glutamine level, and this is also characterized by orotic aciduria, as the carbamoyl phosphate cannot be converted into citrulline, that is the carbamyl group cannot be donated to the ornithine. So in that condition, the carbamyl phosphate undergoes pyrimidine synthesis and there is more production of orotic acid, which is later excreted as orotic acid in the urine, and condition is called as orotic aciduria. The third step is formation of argininosuccinate from citrulline by the action of enzyme argininosuccinate synthetase. In this condition, if this enzyme is defective, there is no formation of argininosuccinate. So there is accumulation of the product which is formed in the second reaction. So this condition is called as citrullinemia. Product accumulated is citrulline. This is autosomal recessive condition. Hyperammonemia is there, but there is citrulline in blood, urine and CSF. The fourth condition means fourth step of urea cycle is formation of arginine from argininosuccinate by action of enzyme argininosuccinase or argininosuccinate lyase. So if this enzyme is defective, then this argininosuccinate cannot be converted into arginine, and that's why there is increased level of argininosuccinate and it is excreted in the urine in the form of argininosuccinate. So it is called as argininosuccinic aciduria. So this is the product which is accumulated, argininosuccinate. It is autosomal recessive condition and it is characterized by metabolic acidosis and trichorhexis nodosa. The fifth urea cycle disorder step is formation of ornithine from arginine by the action of enzyme arginase, and if this arginase is defective, then arginine cannot be converted into urea and ornithine. So there is increased level of arginine in the blood. It is called as hyperarginemia, and product accumulated is arginine. It is autosomal recessive condition. It is the mild urea cycle disorder where symptoms appear by 2 to 4 years of age. The other urea cycle disorder is also N-acetylglutamate synthase deficiency as well as HHS syndrome, which is due to ornithine transporter defect, and that HH syndrome is characterized by hyperornithinemia, hyperammonemia and homocitrullinemia. If you find this video useful, please subscribe, like and share, and thank you for watching.